Good morning. For our call to worship this morning, I'd like to read from Psalms chapter 18, verses 1 through 3. It says this, I love thee, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. My God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies. We would like to welcome you to the Alburnett Christian Church this morning. Some announcements that we'd like to highlight is that Monday, but it's not the 5th, it'd be
Wednesday,
we'll have the Secret Sister Party at 6 o'clock here at the church. A light supper will be served. Anyone wanting to be in to the next year's Secret Sister deal, but that can't attend the actual party, there are some recipe cards in the back by the bulletins. You fill out who you are, your interests, your favorite colors, birthday and anniversary, and then that is what your Secret Sister will get. And that they'll use throughout the next year. Then give it to Pam before the church party, and then they'll have it when they figure out who everybody's secret sister is going to be for the next year. So, and this is open to all church ladies. There will be an elders meeting on the 17th at 6:30. Are there any other announcements that we need to make at this time? Wilbert passed away this last week, and so we'd ask that you keep the family in your prayers. We know that he's with Jesus, and so that's a comfort, but it's still hard to say goodbye to people that you love and care about. And so we'd ask to just kind of keep the family in your prayers. There will be a memorial service for him here at the church on July the 11th. I'm assuming that that's correct. Okay. All right. Are there any other updates or prayer requests that we want to mention at this time? If not, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, as we come before your throne, it is our desire to lift you up and to praise you and to worship you as we see in the book of Revelation that happens all the time. And Heavenly Father, as we come to you, we just are grateful and thankful that we live in a country that is free, where we are able to serve you as we see fit. And Heavenly Father, we just pray that you would be with our country, that you would be with our nation, that you'd be with the leaders of our country, with our president, and Heavenly Father, with those who are cabinet members and members of Congress and the Senate and our judges, that you would help them to make decisions that be wise and honorable and pleasing in your sight, and that Heavenly Father, they would do your will and not their own. We ask, Heavenly Father, that you would just be with our church, that you would help us to reach out to our community and share with them the love of Jesus Christ. And Lord, we pray especially for Katie and Millie and the rest of their family as they are forced to say goodbye to somebody that they love and care for. Heavenly Father, I just pray that you'd help to remind them that one day, that if they're faithful, that they'll get to see him again, and that there will be a grand reunion. I pray now that you be with the rest of our service. I pray that you be with those who are on our prayer list, and that Heavenly Father, you would just meet them at their need and bring victory to your people. It's in Jesus' precious and holy name that we pray. Amen. Our first hymn this morning is hymn number 604. And let's stand. We'll sing first, second, and final verse of hymn number 604. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He had loosed the faithful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
have seen him in the watchfires of 100 circling camps. They have builded him an altar in the evening dews and damps. I can read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. This day is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. That transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us live to make men free. While God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Our next hymn is hymn number 600, America the Beautiful, first, second, and fourth verse. We'll sing first, second, and final verse of America. 602.
My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of from every
for this morning's communion meditation, reading a passage entitled Free in the Spirit, with scripture taken from Acts 4:13, where it says, "They were unschooled, ordinary men, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus." Neither Orville nor Wilbur Wright had a pilot's license. Neither had gone to college. They were bicycle mechanics with the dream and the courage to try to fly. On December 17, 1903, they took turns piloting their Wright Flyer on four separate flights. The longest lasted only a minute, but it changed our world forever. Neither Peter nor John had a preaching license. Neither had gone to seminary. They were fishermen who, filled with the Spirit of Jesus, courageously proclaimed the good news. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. The Wright brothers' neighbors didn't immediately appreciate their accomplishment. Their hometown newspaper didn't believe their story and said that even if true, the flights were too brief to be significant. It took several more years of flying and refining their planes before the public recognized what they had truly done. The religious leaders didn't like Peter and John, and they ordered them to stop telling others about Jesus. Peter said, "No way. We cannot help speaking about what we have seen and have heard." You may not be on the approved list. Perhaps you're scorned by those who are. No matter. If you have the Spirit of Jesus, you're free to live boldly for Him. If you join me this morning, our communion hymn is hymn 433. We'll sing the first, second, and stand that final verse.
Recognize the great sacrifice that Jesus made, coming to earth, living as a man, showing others how to become disciples. And now, for our sins, he has gone to a cross and died and suffered there and rose again. but through rising again, we have salvation if we but come to him. As we take these sacraments, the bread symbolizing the broken body, and the cup symbolizing the blood that flowed freely there at Calvary, we ask that you would strengthen our hearts and always remind us of these great events, that they be etched in our hearts. Lord, we pray as we go out into the community and share these things with the world, that they will accept them and be willing to understand the love of Jesus. We ask these things in your precious and holy name. Amen.
From whom all blessings flow, praise him, all creatures here below, praise him above, ye heavenly host, praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Heavenly Father, as we come to this part of our service, we pause to reflect on the many blessings that you have bestowed on each and every one of us. Lord, we thank you for the freedom that we have, both in Christ and as a nation. And Heavenly Father, as we reflect on the monetary blessings that you have bestowed on us, we give back a portion of that that you have so freely given. As we do so, we ask for your continued blessing on both the gift and the giver, and ask that Heavenly Father, you would help us to use those gifts to reach out to our community and to our world with the love of Jesus to all who will listen. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. This morning, if you would, turn with me to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 3 through 4. It says this, reading from the New International Version. It says, "Endure hardship with us like a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No one serving as a soldier gets involved in civilian affairs. He wants to please his commanding officer." Now, we do have some people here that served in the military, and I'm sure that they could tell us that when they were serving, they weren't able to just do what they wanted, that they had to do what their commanding officer told them to do. You didn't just get to leave the barracks and go to the movie theater or get to go out on a date if you didn't have a pass. Because when you're in the Army, you do what other people tell you to do. You don't get to do what you want to do. There's a story that is told by the young man who served at the Lord's table in church in Jersey City, New Jersey, on Sunday morning, July 11th, in 1943. At the meeting of the Breakfast Club last week, the visitors were asked to stand and give their names. So mind you, this is January 11th, 1943, when this happened. So they were asked to give their names, their businesses, and places of residence. We came to a soldier, and he said about this, "I'm a soldier, and for the duration I have no other name, just an American soldier. I have no business except to fight Uncle Sam's battles, and I have no home. Wherever my government needs me is my home until the war is over and the aims of my government are accomplished." Interesting statement, isn't it? Well, as Christians, we are also in an army. We're in the Lord's army. And as soldiers, there are some things that we need to remember. The first thing that we need to remember is that we don't entangle ourselves with the world. Don't entangle yourself with the world. Let's go back to that 2 Timothy passage. It says, "Endure hardship with us like a good soldier of Christ Jesus." No one serving as a soldier gets involved in civilian affairs. He wants to please his commanding officer. When you serve in the military becomes your life until you're done. That's just the way it is. You eat what Uncle Sam feeds you. You go where Uncle Sam wants you to go. You do what Uncle Sam tells you to do. And that's just the way that it is. Why is it as Christians that we spend so much time acting like this world is all that really matters? You know, the Bible says that our life here on earth is just like a vapor. Have you ever looked out on a cold morning when you went out to start your car because it's cold out and you see the white smoke coming out of the exhaust? It isn't there too long before it just disappears and evaporates. Well, that's kind of the way our life is. We're here for just a brief moment, and then we move on. Yet, we spend so much time thinking about the brief part of our life and very little time thinking about the eternity that is to follow. If I were to ask you what heaven is going to be like, what is your mental picture of heaven? Is it like the Saturday morning cartoons with like Bugs Bunny, where they have a halo and they float up into the air until they're on a cloud and they're playing. Is that playing a harp? Is that your mental image of what heaven is going to be like? Or are you like many people and have really no idea what it is that you're hoping for? You just hope it's going to be better than what's here. You see, I think part of the reason that we don't yearn for heaven is that we have no concept of what it is that we're looking forward to. Can you imagine what life would be like if you had absolutely nothing to do? Some of you are probably saying, Dan, that'd be wonderful. Maybe for about a day, right? I mean, sure. I mean, every one of us would like a break from like going to work, you know, mowing the lawn, doing the chores. But we're designed to do things. And sitting around doing nothing, that's not what we're designed for. And in fact, people who just retire and do nothing, a lot of times don't live very long. Because we are designed to do things. When we get to heaven, we're not just going to sit on a cloud playing a harp. We're going to do things. There are going to be jobs for us to do. And I think that those jobs will be aligned with interests and skills that we have developed in this life. I imagine there's an older lady in her like 90s when I was at Puxico. She had glaucoma, she was nearly blind. But she loved to garden. I don't know how she saw what was in it, but she loved to garden. And I remember her one time telling me, you know, she said, Dan, you know, there's times I just like to walk barefoot in my garden and feel the dirt in between my toes. I imagine that Maddie is somewhere in heaven taking care of a garden somewhere because that's something that she loved to do. I imagine when Melanie gets to heaven, she's going to be somewhere around animals. She loves animals. I can, in my mind's eye, picture Melanie when she gets to heaven just sitting down in a field and letting all of the animals come so that she can pet them. Tigers, lions, bears, whatever, you know. I can see her, you know, lying there just saying, here, kitty, kitty, because she loves animals, right? When we get to heaven, there's going to be things for us to do, but it's going to be things that we enjoy doing. I don't think Melanie will be sewing. She finds sewing really frustrating, right? There's some people that love that. And it's amazing that God has made us all so different and so special. But don't focus only on this world. A good soldier keeps in mind where he's at and what's important. In Philippians 2, 3, and 4, it says this, "No, dear brothers and sisters, I am not all I should be, but I am focusing on all my energies on this one thing, forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead. I strain to reach the end of the race and receive the prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling us up to heaven." Paul there is saying this. He says, I know I'm not exactly where I ought to be, but I'm investing all of my effort into looking forward to what lies ahead. I strain to reach the end of the race so that I may receive the prize which God is calling me up to heaven. Is that true of us? When I was younger, we had this game that we would play with the young people. And we would gather them all together, and we would tell them that the goal was to fill out this paper. It was the success story, and it had five different centers in it. There's a learning center and a laughing center, and I don't remember what all the centers were. And in each center, there was five things that you had to do, and you had to sign off on each one, get a signature to sign off on each one. So it might be, you know, 20 push-ups and 20 sit-ups, and I don't know what all, right? In the learning center, you might have to name five state capitals. And you try to get all these kids worked up into a frenzy to try and get this done as fast as they can. But as they're doing this, there's these two other groups of people. They're prophets, right? And there's false prophets and there's good prophets. And so the one group of people is encouraging them to finish, you know, their success story, to keep working on it. And the other group of people are coming up to these young people and telling them that they need to trade their success story in for a death certificate. And it says, this is to certify that so-and-so has died and is, died to the success story and blah, blah, blah. I don't remember. Right? And you tell them that when they hear the trumpet sound, that they're all to come back together. And so they play the sound and they come together and somebody is reading the scripture where they separate the sheep from the goats. And they separate all of those people with their success story from the people with the death certificate. And it isn't until the very end of the game that they realize that the thing that they should have been pursuing the entire time was the death certificate. That they died to themselves so that they could win. Well, doesn't that sound a lot like Christianity? We have a whole world that's out there telling us to pursue these things so that you can be successful. To have this amount of money in the bank or this many cars in your driveway or this kind of house. And if you do those things, that you will be successful. And Jesus says, all you really need is me. Die to yourself so that you can live with me. And when these kids finally realize what's happened, they get this shocked look on their face because they were deceived. And they had pursued the wrong thing. And they totally believed that that was what they were supposed to do. The question is this: how many people are going to stand before God someday and be shocked because they were deceived by the world and pursued what they thought was right, but ultimately was wrong? You see, a good soldier doesn't entangle himself in the world. Secondly, as a good soldier of Christ, we need to wear the name of Christ. We need to wear the name of Christ. Matthew 10, 32 and 33 says this: all those who stand before others and say they believe in me, I will say before my Father in heaven that they belong to me. But all who stand before others and say they do not believe in me, I will say before my Father in heaven that they do not belong to me. So Jesus is saying there, if you acknowledge me before men, I will acknowledge you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me before men, I'll deny you before my Father who is in heaven. Whose name do you wear? Do you wear the name of Christ? In Hebrews 6, 4 through 6, there's this passage of scripture. Hebrews 4, Hebrews 10. So Hebrews is written, is the only book in the New Testament that's written in Hebrew because it's written to Jews. And the entire book of Hebrews is an encouragement to not give up on their Christian faith. Don't go back to Judaism. Continue to remain a Christian. And every so often, the author of Hebrews will stop and he will encourage the writers to don't give up. So he will talk about how Jesus is superior to Moses and how Jesus is superior to Aaron and how Jesus is superior to angels. And then he'll stop and he'll encourage them to not give up on their faith. Well, this is one of those points where the author is saying, don't give up. And he says this, for it is impossible to restore to repentance those who are enlightened, those who have experienced the good things of heaven and shared in the Holy Spirit, who have tasted the goodness of the Word of God and the power of the age to come, and who then turn away from God. It is impossible to bring such people to repentance again, because they are nailing the Son of God to the cross again by rejecting him, holding him up to public shame. Now, there are some churches that teach that once you're saved, you're always saved, and that you cannot be lost. And I do believe that the devil can't make you, he cannot take you away from God. But I do believe that you can do it on your own. Because as long as there's life and breath in your body, you have the ability to choose who you will serve. And once you draw that last breath, whatever choice you've made is the one you're going to live with for all of eternity. I'm going to have Gene put that verse back up there for just a minute, because I want you to look closely at it. It says, for it is impossible to restore to repentance those who are once enlightened, those who have experienced the good things of heaven and shared in the Holy Spirit, who have tasted the goodness of the Word of God and the power of the age to come. Does that sound like somebody who's never accepted Jesus? Or does that sound like somebody who has accepted Jesus and experienced all that Christianity has to offer? I mean, that's what it looks like to me. That the author here of Hebrews is describing somebody who has accepted Jesus, experienced all the things that Christianity has had to offer, and then turned his back on it. Verse 6 says, and then who turn away from God, it is impossible to bring such people to repentance again, because they are nailing the Son of God to the cross again by rejecting him, holding him up to public shame. It says there that those people who have experienced everything that Christianity has to offer and then walks away, it's just like they're nailing Jesus to the cross again. Whose name do you wear? If you claim to be a Christian, do you act like you're a Christian? The Bible says, not everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom of heaven. This morning, Melanie got up early because she was hurting. And she was watching a show on these prosperity evangelists. and how they have really deceived a lot of people and the harm that they have done. And Melanie said to me, Dan, you don't really think those people are going to go to heaven, do you? And I quoted that verse that not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Jesus says, in that day, there are people who will come to me and they will say, Lord, Lord, did I not preach in your name? Did I not do miracles in your name? And I will say to them, depart from me because I what? I never knew you. Not I never knew who you were, but that we never had a relationship. Whose name do you wear? And is it obvious to people who are around you? And then finally, remember that we have no permanent home here. Remember that we have no permanent home here. In 1 Peter 2:11 through 12, it says this, Beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from the fleshly lusts which war against your soul. Having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works which they observe, glorify the God in the day of his visitation. Peter says there that we are sojourners. A sojourner is somebody who is just passing through. It's not their home. They're on their way somewhere else. And that as sojourners, we abstain from the fleshly lusts which war against the soul. And then he goes on to say that our conduct should be such that when people, evildoers, speak out against us, that our conduct makes it clear that that's not true. Can you imagine if I were to say about Chad that he is a huge Minnesota Vikings fan, right? Anybody who knows Chad would say, you are a liar, right? Because they know he's a Chicago Bears fan all the way. They'd know that I'm lying because if they went to his house, if they saw him, you know, on Sunday watching the football games, and they saw who he is, they would know, it would be immediately obvious that this is a Chicago Bears fan, right? When I was growing up, I lived a super boring life. My parents were pretty strict. It's a good thing, because I got into trouble anyway. But any given night, I was probably in bed by 10 o'clock, right? And so my mom told me that, like, after I went to Bible college, there was this rumor that I was, like, some sort of party animal, right? And my mom just laughed because she knew better, right? One look at my life, and you're like, that guy is the most boring guy I've ever met, right? So, but that's the way it should be about our Christianity, that we live our life in such a way that if people say, that guy's a Minnesota Vikings fan, they know better. They know that's not true because that's not the way that we live our life. That they'll know that we are Christians and that by our actions, God is glorified. In Hebrews 11, verses 8 through 10, it says this. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place that he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents and did as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations whose architect and builder was God. Now, this is This is an amazing verse. Because what this Bible verse says is that Abraham lived in a tent for basically almost all of his life because he was looking for the New Jerusalem. What is the one city whose foundations and architect and builder is God? The only one I'm familiar with is the New Jerusalem found in the book of Revelation. How did Abraham even know about it? I don't know. But it says there that he lived in tents while he looked for the city whose builder was God. You know, we don't much talk about it, but it really took quite a bit of faith for Abraham to pack up and leave. They did some archaeological work, and they've discovered Ur. And it is perhaps one of the oldest cities that actually had like a sewer system in it. Abraham left the modern conveniences of his world to spend the rest of his life living in a tent. Now, I like to camp, but I don't want to live in one forever. Can I get an amen? Is there anybody who agrees with me? Right? It's fun to go camping, but nobody wants to camp forever. It's nice to come home and sit in your recliner, turn on the TV, and have the air conditioning on. Right? But Abraham left all of the modern conveniences that his world knew at that time and spent the rest of his life living in a tent because God told him to go. How about us? Do we live like this world is not our permanent home? Do we look forward to the world that's to come? When I was little, I once told my mom that we have this whole thing backwards. That we needed to start out old, get all the yucky stuff out of the way, and get younger, right? And my mom, who is a very wise lady, said, yeah, but Dan, if it worked that way, what would there be to cause us to look forward to going to heaven? And there's so much truth to that. Melanie, when we were first married, was really scared of childbirth. With good reason, right? It's not exactly an exciting, wonderful time, right? Nobody looks forward to the actual labor. But when Melanie was pregnant with Andrew, by the time she got to 9 months, she was ready. Because God has a way of getting us ready for what's to come next. When I was 20 years old, I wasn't ready for heaven. There was too many awesome things to do, right? I mean, just met Melanie, was looking forward to a life with her, and just so many things on the whole world was my oyster, right? Did any of you guys feel like that when you were young? Maybe one or two. Don't see where my hands, right? But as I've gotten older, my eyes don't work as good. My body hurts in places that I didn't even know I had. And more as I get older, I get more and more homesick for heaven. Because people that I love and I care about, more and more of them are there, and less of them are here. Now, I still have people here I love and care about, but as each day passes, I find that I yearn more for heaven because God is getting me ready for the next step. How about you? Jesus said that where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Where's your treasure this morning? And if it's not in heaven, then I suggest that you put it there. This morning, if you have a decision that you'd like to make, we invite and encourage you to come as we sing our invitation hymn. Our invitation hymn is hymn number 377. Let's stand as we sing hymn number 377. Father, as we once more come before your throne, I just want to thank you so much for allowing us to live in a country that's free, where we're able to serve you as we see fit. I pray, Heavenly Father, that you would continue to be with America, that you would send a revival to America, that you would draw us back to yourself so that we can once more be a nation, one nation under God, indivisible, united. Heavenly Father, as we approach the holiday, help us not only to celebrate our independence as a nation, but our independence from sin that was bought for us by Jesus. All these things we ask and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.